And welcome to this special edition of Boom News Plus Business Standard, look at the railway budget that's coming up in a few days. One interesting development today, we've seen a new record for a passenger train going at 160 kilometers per hour between Delhi and Agra. The big question is, will this and other developments take the railways to the next generation as they've been hoping to for many years? That's not, of course, the only thing we're talking about. We're trying to understand what are the larger issues at play ahead of the Indian railways. Safety, security, of course, being some of the most critical ones. To discuss that, I'm joined now by Jayaprakash Batra, the former chairman of the railway board. I'm also joined to get a user perspective, Sanjay Ladiwala, chairman of the Cement Stockists and Dealers Association in Mumbai. And he's going to tell us about how he sees it from his perspective as moving commodities across on the railways. I also spoke to Rakesh Mohan, a former deputy governor of the Reserve Bank, now with the IMF, and he had this to say on the capacity or freight capacity of the Indian Railways.
That investment in the railways has remained around constant at 0.4% of GDP. So, whereas in, say, in the 1980s, 90s, investment in the railways and roads were about the same as a proportion of GDP, roads has gone up. We've seen the good consequences. Railways has remained around 0.4% GDP. So what we have recommended is, you really need to concentrate on the railways and bring that up to something like 1% of GDP plus. And the couple of implications of that, one is that today the trunk routes of railways are totally clogged now, both for passengers as well as for freight. What has happened in the last 20 years is that there have been a number of changes, improvements in productivity, where from the same track length, you've actually been able to improve both passenger throughput as well as freight throughput. Now you've come almost to the end of those possibilities, so you have to invest. The good thing is that we've started the dedicated freight corridor projects, and so those have to be accelerated. Once you do that, then the freight goes off the trunk routes and the passenger traffic can be much faster, and also you free up the existing track for all of passenger transport. So in some sense the foundations are already there, but you have to accelerate it unless you have a major reform of the railway system.
Right, so there you are, Rakesh Mohan there speaking about some of the challenges as a percentage, I mean, and the investment called for, particularly as a percentage of GDP compared to roads. Okay, let's get some reactions first.
The railway hike is concerned, as far as they give facilities to the price that they are charging. Otherwise, from this budget, I really want to see funds being allocated for the quadrilateral program that they've talked about bullet trains coming to Mumbai and also increasing the speed of the ongoing local trains. If that happens, it's a good news for the citizens of this country.
And if you've increased the price of the tickets, then as a woman, I'd like you to invest a large part of that in ensuring that women feel safe on a train. Extra measures to ensure that no matter what the time of the day is, women can feel safe to travel by public transport. Today I don't travel that much by public transport based because of the way things are going. So this is my primary concern.
As we've already seen that there's been a hike in the fares, coming years can justify whether this hike was rightful or not, but I believe that the investment in this industry is very important.
About the railway budget, I don't think this fare hike is justified, to be very honest. I mean, especially when you see a lot of people move from the first class to the second class right now. So that being said and done, I think one thing that I would like to see in this budget is better facilities for the railway.
Right, so better facilities for railways, you can see the wonderful Mumbai rains there in the backdrop. Mr. Batra, let me come back to you. We're trying to understand two things here primarily. I think one is, what is the direction that is expected and needed from the budget, the railway budget, and to some extent have we already seen that direction being set with the tariff hikes that we saw last week? And secondly, if the direction and thrust is clear, in what way should it or would it play out in coming weeks? In coming months. So these are the two questions. So let me begin by asking you the first one. What's are you in general agreement with the way things are going in the new regime in the railways, and what are the tasks that you still feel need to be done?
I I must compliment the new railway minister for catching the bull by the horns, first by raising the passenger fares and correcting the freight rates marginally. The most important thing for the railways is to set its own house in order in financial terms. The railway was in the last 5 years drifting. The expenditure was rising. The incomes were only improving marginally. This was this can be seen from the way operating ratio has shot up to over 90% now. And therefore, there was a need to correct the imbalance, to improve the railway's finances. And the first step that has been taken is very much in the right direction. And it's an indicator of things to follow. And I am sure many more steps which are needed in this direction would be taken, starting from the first budget to be presented by the Railway Minister now on 8th. Let us hope that railways finances are put on better footing.
Right. So we'll come to finances and their breakdown in a little bit, Mr. Batra. But if you were to look at the total gap between what the railways earns, particularly from passenger and freight, and its expenditure, where can that gap be filled, and is it important or critical for that gap to be filled, let's say, by moves like tariff hikes?
70%, generally 70% of the earnings of the railways get contributed by the freight and the balance by passenger and other coaching earnings. Freight, therefore, is a very, very important segment, and traditionally, the freight has been taxed a little more subsidize the losses of the passenger earnings, but also to improve its financial position. There is a limit up to which freight rates can be raised. That the industry's action would make it very clear. However, freight rates also have to keep pace with the increase in cost of inputs and the cost of living. Roughly, about 26,000 crores or so of losses are being made by the passenger traffic, as you would have noticed also in various papers. And the present fare hike would only take care of about 5,000 crores out of it. Therefore, there is a need to do much more in the coming years to gradually reduce this gap of reduce the losses. The intention essentially is to generate surpluses for investment. Today, railway doesn't have adequate internal generation to improve its investment portfolio. It is very heavily dependent on gross budgetary support from the central government. And central government has its limitations. They will not be able to help the railways by more than 30,000-35,000 crores by way of gross budgetary support. Whereas the government, whereas the railway needs roughly about 70,000 crores plus of investment every year.
Right. Okay. So I'm going to again delve into that in a bit. Sanjay, let me come to you. What's your sense about from as a consumer of services from the railways in terms of where freight costs are, or the efficiency of delivering or even using railways as a transport mode? Sanjay, can you, I don't know if you got the question. My question was, I'll just repeat that, as a user of the railways, what's your sense of the value that you get in using railways to transport commodities, and to what extent, and I'm talking about cement in particular, and to what extent do you see it playing a competitive role? Okay, right. I think we've lost Sanjay. Let me come back to you, Mr. Batra. So, you know, the other point that we've seen this test run of a passenger train running at 160 kilometers per hour between Delhi and Agra. Potentially, we could see more trains running, I'm assuming, more consistently at that speed as opposed to hitting a peak speed. We've also talked about diamond quadrilateral, and we are talking about high speed trains. How is this all balancing out when it comes to the fundamental needs of the Indian Railways?
A few things which we must understand. We were already running trains at a few trains at 150 kilometers. It is now proposed to increase the speed to 160 kilometers on Delhi-Agra Bhopal route. For running the train at 160, I am sure the trials would have been taken by the Commissioner of Railway Safety at 180 kilometers or a little over that. It is only when he finds all criteria satisfied at those higher speeds that will he permit 160 kilometers as the maximum speed. Now, having said that, we must also realize that most of my trunk routes on the Indian Railways today are running to super saturation level, which means there is a limited capacity of introducing any more trains. And every time I introduce a super fast train of this nature, I have to sacrifice 2 to 3 goods trains, freight trains. It is the freight trains which is the milch cow of the Indian Railways. So the introduction of trains at 160 kilometer will come at a price. Yet, we need to introduce trains at 160 kilometers to ensure that we remain technically sound in that area. And therefore, I see some trains at 160 kilometer speed getting introduced on some of the routes, but they will not get proliferated all over the Indian Railways immediately.
So, you know, when we talk about, the diamond quadrilateral and high speed, we're obviously talking about building fresh railway track and which will have the ability to run very high speed trains. My question is, what is the Indian Railways management bandwidth to do both at the same time? I mean, which is all the problems that it's facing with the resource constraints and taking on ambitious new projects like high-speed rail networks. And I'm not talking about the 160 kilometers, but the faster, the bullet train-like propositions that are being talked about.
High-speed rail networks generally runs on standalone separate systems, separate set of track corridors will be needed for running high-speed trains. Normally, a track corridor on the existing broad gauge corridor to a pair of lines requires roughly about 7 to 8 crore a kilometer on the surface level. In case of freight corridor, Indian Railways would be spending something like 30 to 40 crores a kilometer for a corridor per kilometer. In case of metro lines, the expenditure is around 175 to 180 to 200 crores a kilometer because it involves elevated track as well as underground track. In case of high-speed trains also, the expenditure is going to be not less than 170 to 200 crores a kilometer of high-speed corridor. It's going to be immensely costly proposition. Railways do not have the money to invest. In case of freight corridors, two corridors are sanctioned where the cost is going to be 30 to 40 crores a kilometer. Western corridor is coming up with financial assistance from Japan. Eastern corridor is coming up with financial help from World Bank. Expansion of freight corridors will require similar help from other outside sources. Similar would be the fate of high-speed corridors.
Right.
But since state governments are going to be the biggest beneficiaries, state governments along with central government and Indian Railways will have to be the partners in this effort besides getting majority of financial input from outside sources, it could be Japan, it could be World Bank, it could be China or any other player in the field.
Right. Okay, so we've also got Vishwas Udirkar of Udirkar, Senior Director at Deloitte joining us. Vishwas, a quick question for you. I mean, I know that you've studied and are studying the logistics as a whole space more quite closely. What are the kind of challenges that you see that Indian Railways faces at this point of time as we go into this to the budget for 2014-15?
Always it is good to basically announce the ambitious programs. And I think for a long-term perspective, that is important. That will give the good line of, direction for planning. But I think important is to immediately actually concentrate on some of the similar programs or the projects already announced. Like taken for example, the dedicated freight corridor, both Delhi-Mumbai as well as the Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor.
Right.
I think we need to concentrate on first building that, because today the freight, the lines are actually choked basically, both these lines, and just to move extra freight effectively or efficiently, we don't have the capacities. So while we can plan for the larger big ticket projects, I'm talking more from the freight side, like building up the diamond quadrilaterals and all that, immediately we should see that, review these projects and try to complete this on the, put these projects on the fast track and complete today. That is important for the survival of railways.
Right. Vishwas, I'm going to come back to you in a second. I think, Sanjay, we've got you back. The question that I was asking you is really, how efficient or effective is the railways as a mover of commodities, particularly from your point of view, and what is it competing against?
Well, basically, in the cement, railways competes with the road transport. Though road transport is not very effective economically, it's not a very viable thing for long distances. So about 60% of cement is transported by railways. And what we are seeing is that a lot of efficiency has to be brought in here besides capex. Because you see, in the last 5 years, an average of about 20 million tons capacity has been added.
Mm-hmm.
But commensurately, no rolling stock has been added by the railways. Therefore, it's very difficult to get rakes, and the cement industry has to depend more and more on road transportation, which is unviable and sometimes very expensive. There have been a lot of experiments to increase the efficiency, the turnaround of rakes, but none of them has really succeeded. So I think the railways have to put a real thought behind how to more efficiently use the stock which is available, and for planning in the future, because we are expecting another 30 million tons this year, another 18 million tons next year. So that's going to add to the inflow of material, and unless there is the vehicle to carry it to the point of consumption, it's going to create logistical bottlenecks, which is in fact going to be nothing but raising prices in certain regions,
right,
which is not warranted.
Right. Right. So, Mr. Batra, I think there are 2 points. One is cement, as Sanjay Ladiwala pointed out. The other is coal, which if we were to keep in mind the kind of economic growth targets we are setting, for which you need power, for which you need to move coal, we seem to be facing a considerable gap in capacity when it comes to moving all of this. What's your outlook there?
View that railway will have to improve its productivity to pick up greater share of traffic being offered, particularly the bulk traffic like coal and cement. Cement has been a constant battle with the railways. Railways have been trying earnestly to improve its rail share from 60% to 80% and beyond. Railway has introduced Own Your Wagon scheme also, whereby they can reduce their capital investment and generate adequate incentives for the industry to own their wagons, so that the shortage of wagons can be taken care of. However, industry feels that railway will have to tweak those rules and give a little extra consideration for owners of these wagons. To make it attractive for them to invest into the Own Your Wagon scheme. So I think this is an area where railways should also think more about attracting more and more investment from industry into the Own Your Wagon scheme to improve wagon supply to the industry.
Right. Vishwaske, if I can come back to you, if you look at the demand side and you know, things we need to do to you know, grow the economy and obviously move all the cement and coal that we talked about, what are the challenges there? How do you see you know, the situation shaping up?
No, see, the railway, as you know, has a both responsibility of both the passenger and the freight. Passenger is more a social responsibility, and freight is, it is a, you know, backbone of the whole economic activity. Now, we balance how you achieve is important. Now, on the freight side, as I told that we have the two main corridors which you are talking about. Last 10 years, originally it was to be completed by 2013-14. Today, we are nowhere even closer to that. It's you know, it's a very, very initial stage. So if you set up that, and Eastern, for example, Eastern Corridor is very important from the coal transportation point of view. Western is from the all from the overall economic activity point of view. It's the whole North Indian movement of goods, both exim cargo. It is entirely moved from North India to both these port sides, and more important, the Western port side. And we today don't have the capacity. So right. I think that focus has to be on these two projects. That's what I feel immediately. How do we complete this project on target, or what are the targets we set up and all that? And while doing that, we can talk about, you know, high speed trains or the bullet trains and all, because any of these are 1 to 10 year kind of a implementation right. time span. It requires all these things, and these are more for, unless and until you set up the basics of railway, you know, there is no point in going for the bullet trains and high-speed trains.
Right.
That's the second, I give the second priority to do that. First priority is to improve or provide the additional capacity for the freight movement.
Right. Okay. So we'll come back to the capacity in a moment, Mr. Batra. What about non tariff or non traditional sources of revenue? I mean, you know, all the other sources which could be monetizing, let's say, land or offering other services which use, let's say, railway infrastructure. What are the possible sources of revenue there, and can that bring about some kind of balance?
Non-traditional sources of revenue will need to be thought of, will thought of and explored in a significant way. These include raising money by using land, which is a very big asset available with the railways, and Rail Land Development Authority has been formed. But so far, its big ticket success is yet to be seen. Some more greater push is needed. Commercial publicity, parcel earnings, sundry earnings are some of the other areas where they'll have to push more. But parallelly along with this, the railways will have to pay equal attention to expenditure control. It is spending huge amount of money on staff. 55% of its ordinary working expenses get spent on the staff. And yet there is a clamor for increasing the staff. What is needed is increasing the productivity of the staff by mechanization and reducing the staff strength, thereby reducing expenditure. That will help in generating greater levels of surpluses within the railways. And one other most effective way of reducing expenditure and liabilities is that railway must focus on core activity, and gradually non-core activities must be offloaded. Why should railways be running schools and hospitals and hostels? Why can't railway privatize freight terminals and station improvement areas? Why should the railways own up, set up new production units at its own cost? Private industry is willing to do it. Even the existing production units, why can't they be corporatized if not privatized?
Right. Capacity in cement is going up sharply. We need the ability to move that, else there will be a significant impact on prices at market. Did I get that right?
Absolutely correct. That's what it is. And for that, we need not only capex, but much more efficient utilization of the infrastructure which is available today.
Right. And Sanjay, is there something that you feel can be done in the immediate future which can perhaps address some of these issues?
One thing that comes to mind is mechanization of unloading of rakes, where normally it's done manually and takes a very long time. Just the faster turnaround rakes itself would increase carrying capacity. So if there's mechanization used for unloading wagons, I think it would increase the capacity, carrying capacity substantially.
Right. Thanks, Sanjay, for that. Mr. Batra, last word. Your sense of what are the two or three key things that the budget should look at in order to address some of the larger issues that are facing us, both from a passenger safety and security point of view, as well as a freight capacity and an economic point of view?
Broadly, railway must improve its financial health and aim for operating ratio of 80% during the next year, and over in a programmed basis of 75% thereafter, which means increasing revenues and reducing expenditure both. It needs a holistic approach to railways finances and railway operations and railway productivity. Second, railway will have to devote far greater attention to safety. In 2000-2001, when the same NDA government was in power, it grappled with this idea, introduced non-lapsable safety fund of 17,000 crore, 12,000 crore of which was set up given by the central government, 5,000 crore of which was to be generated by the railways itself from its own resources. And this has helped railways improve the accident position by over 80% from a level of almost 500 accidents in 1999-2000 or so. It has come down to now about 100. One more similar push is now needed. Kakutkar committee report is already with them. Phase one of that requires an expenditure of 40,000 crores. Overall expenditure is about 1 lakh crores, as suggested in the report. 40,000 crore must be planned for investment through various methodologies. One experiment is already known to them. And lastly, people are crying for improving amenities facilities. Railway will have to continue increasing passenger fares in line with the cost of input, and it will increase passenger reaction in demanding more and more facilities, and therefore passenger amenities will need greater focus and attention from the railways. Lastly, some of the sections of the railways would be ready for carrying 25-ton axle load, which is the next jump which the railway must take. Already a few sections where 25-ton axle load is being carried. Generally, Indian Railway carries 23-ton per axle load, which really means earning more per wagon, per meter of the track, etc., thereby improving productivity of assets. It is possible, even with the existing assets, by giving focused attention to weak areas on identified ore-carrying routes, mineral routes, and heavier routes, and 25-ton per axle load can be introduced. It will give a big boost to the railway's earnings.
Right. Mr. Batra, we've run out of time completely. Thank you for joining us and giving us a sense on what the key priorities are. Raising finances, balancing the financial situation, using that to focus on safety, and of course, making the system far more efficient in terms of turnaround. Thank you, Sanjay, for your inputs, and Vishwas as well. Thank you so much for joining us on the India Hangout Budget Special along with Business Standard. We'll be back.